Welcome to Orthodontic Lecture Series from Savita Dental College. Growth and Development. Postnatal growth will be covered in two topics, theories of growth and postnatal growth. Here in this video we'll cover the theories of growth. Remodeling theory is one of the earliest theory to be proposed by Brash in 1934. According to this theory, bone grows by apposition on the outer surface and resorption on the inner surface in order to maintain the thickness of bone. The growth of the jaws occurs due to the growth on the posterior surface of the maxilla and the mandible. But this theory could not explain the role of cartilage and sutures. The genetic theory states that the genes determine and control the whole process of craniofacial growth. But simple Mendelian transmission does not explain many aspects of the craniofacial growth. The sutural theory, according to this theory by Seisher, sutures are primary centers of growth like the epiphyseal plates of the long bone. Proliferation of cells happens here, resulting in growth of the suture, which in turn results in growth of the bone. Example of this is the growth of the cranial vault. But this theory does not explain the role of cartilages, and if sutures were transplanted into the guinea pig, it does not grow, hence showing that sutures are not primary growth centers. The cartilaginous theory by Scott. According to this theory, cartilages have intrinsic growth potential and hence are primary growth centers. The growth of cartilage in the nasal septum provides force that displaces the maxilla in the downward and forward direction. The sutural growth is passive and only secondary to the cartilaginous growth. The nasal septum, which is a major contributor to the maxillary growth, and in mandible, the condylar cartilage is considered the growth center. The chondrocranium and periosteum are primary growth centers and hence are controlled by the intrinsic growth factors, which is the genes, whereas the sutural growth and desmocranial growth acts are controlled by the local epigenetic factors or the environmental factors. Here is a patient whose nasal septal cartilage was removed at the age of 8, and here you can see the obvious facial deformity due to the removal of the septum. Functional matrix theory by Moss. According to this theory, the cranial component consists of the functional matrix and the skeletal unit. The periosteal matrix affects the microskeletal unit, causing transformation of bone, and the capsular matrix affects the macroskeletal unit, causing translation of bone, and both in turn produces the growth of the bone. An example of the neurocranium, where the brain is the capsular matrix and the temporalis muscle is the periosteal matrix. The sutures are the microskeletal and the cranial vault is the macroskeletal unit. As you can see, the muscle functions and the brain grows, the cranial vault also increases in size. Here are the various periosteal matrix and their corresponding microskeletal unit, and the capsular matrix and their corresponding macroskeletal unit. Here is a clinical example where the form is affected by the function. TMJ ankylosis resulting in reduced jaw movement, which in turn reduced the growth of the mandible. Here in orthodontic treatment, the brackets on the tooth surface acts on the periosteal matrix, affecting the microskeletal unit, in this case is the alveolar bone. The headgear restraining the maxilla is also an example of the functional matrix theory, where the maxilla is the macroskeletal unit and the headgear is the capsular matrix. The servo system theory. According to this theory, the stimulus produces an effect, and this effect is measured by the neurons, and this information is passed on to the central nervous system, which produces a modified impulse which regulates the effect caused by the stimulus. An example, clinical example, is that the maxillary growth results in occlusal deviation, which is picked up by the proprioceptive impulses in periodontal ligament and TMJ, producing signals to CNS, which affects the muscle function. And the hormonal factors also affect the muscle function and condylar growth, hence resulting in a deviation in the occlusion again. Here is a clinical situation example of an orthodontic treatment producing stimulus, which is picked up by the brain, which again produces proprioceptive stimulus to the muscles, which again controls the kind of treatment which progresses. Enloe's counterpart principle. According to this principle, the growth of any structure relates superficially to other structures and geometric counterparts in the face and the cranium. And here is the example of the parts and their counterparts. Thank you.